Thank you. So hello to everyone. First of all, thanks to the organizers for organizing this nice event and for giving me this opportunity to present my work. My today's presentation will be divided into two parts. In the first one, I will present this PolFET, which is a scheme for exact diagonalization of large sparse matrices. And in the second part, I will show how this scheme can be applied to a phenomenon of many-body localization. But let me start with introduction. So the field I'm interested in is the field of ergodicity of isolated quantum many-body systems. The basic setting one is interested in is a Clenjec experiment in which we have certain initial state and we want to see how the system evolves and whether it approaches some kind of equilibrium. So an example of such state is plotted in here. This is a system of hard-coded bosons. It was considered in this paper in 2008. And the system is prepared initially in such a way that half of the system is filled by hard-coded bosons and the rest of the system is empty. So if we think about some classical counterpart of such an experiment, this would correspond to particles of gas gathered in half of the room, and at the certain moment we start the evolution, we allow them to explore the whole phase space, and as we know in classical physics, the particles will quickly fill up the whole volume of the container they are stored in. And then the thermal equilibrium is attained in such system. So if we think about isolated quantum many-body system, actually quite similar thing is happening. If we look at some observables, either occupation of the zero momentum mode or momentum distribution of those particles, then we will see that initially, once the time evolution starts, there are some changes in the values of those observables, but then the particles fill the whole system, attain a uniform density profile, and then everything is time independent after some initial transient. And once this equilibrium state is reached by the system, then the system can be described by appropriate microcanonical or canonical ensembles. So to see it in a little bit more details, let us consider certain many-body quantum Hamiltonian H, which has its eigenstates psi m and eigenenergies em, and consider arbitrary initial state, which can be expanded in the basis of eigenstates of this many-body Hamiltonian. If we now consider time evolution of an arbitrary local observable, and we look at its average value, then plugging the expansion of the initial state in the eigenstates of the systems, we will see that the observable at a certain time is given by such a double sum. And now if we look at the average of this observable over a long time window, then only diagonal terms, the m equal to n terms, survive in this sum because of the long time average. And so far this is just a general expression from quantum mechanics. And now the main foundational hypothesis of the ergodicity in isolated quantum many-body system is eigenstate thermalization hypothesis, which states that the specific initial condition which is encoded in those coefficients Cm does not matter for this equilibrium long time average of a local observable, and this value of this observable is just given by a sum over a certain microcanonical ensemble, which is determined by the initial state, by its energy and its energy spread, which can be written in such a by such a thermal average. Okay, and now this is the usual situation in quantum many-body systems that they do approach this thermal equilibrium, and then they fulfill the eigenstate thermalization hypothesis. However, there are known exceptions to that behavior, and one of the exceptions is the phenomenon of many-body localization, in which quantum many-body system is in presence of strong disorder. So I'm going to describe an experiment which was done in 2015. It was an optical lattice with fermions, which could hop between adjacent sides of the lattice. They interact via spin up, spin down density interaction. And there is the quasi-periodic potential, which plays the role of disorder in such a system. And now we consider an initial state such that each even side of the lattice is occupied by a fermion, and each odd side is empty. And we consider a so-called imbalance, which is an observable, which is roughly total population of the even sides minus total population of the odd sides. And we look at its time evolution. So there are two possibilities. For small delta, the imbalance, there is some initial transient. Imbalance is initially equal to one, and then it decays to zero very quickly if delta is small. This means that after some time evolution, uniform density profile is reached by the system, and the system then fulfills the eigenstate thermalization hypothesis. However, if this delta is large, which means that the system is in strong disorder, this is no longer the case. Even after a long time of time evolution, a non-zero value of imbalance is present in the system, which means that the initial state, that the traces of the initial state are present in the system even after a long time of time evolution, which means that the eigenstate thermalization is invalid, because this average value of imbalance encodes some information of the initial state. And this means that the system is many-body localized. Yeah. So that was a generic setting. In theoretical calculations, the easiest systems in which one can study phenomenon of many-body localization, easiest from the point of view of computational methods, are spin chains, because the on-signed Hilbert space is just two-dimensional. And the standard model of MBL is XXZ spin one-half chain, which has the spin flip part. There is a Z-SZ interaction, and and disorder enters via a random on-site magnetic field. And usually one assumes a box distribution from minus W to W, where W is some disorder strength. And when one is looking from theoretical perspective at such a model, one could simulate time evolution of such model, just simulating an experiment. However, in order to be really sure that the system is localized or not, one would have to extrapolate the results to infinite time, which is the same as looking at the eigenstates of the systems of this system, or also at the properties of eigenvalues. And the most straightforward probe, which allows one to distinguish systems which are localized and ergodic, is level statistics through the so-called gap ratio, variable R, which is a quantity which is obtained from properties of eigenvalues of a system. And the eigenvalues which are taken into account in such calculations are eigenvalues in the middle of the spectrum. So they are associated with highly excited eigenstates of the system, rather than the for example, something close to the ground state. So we have generic eigenstates and their eigenvalues, and from them we calculate gap ratio. And then at small disorder, this gap ratio attains value which corresponds to some random matrix theory, which means that the system is ergodic. And once we increase disorder strength, this average gap ratio decreases. And once it acquires Poisson value, which means that the energy levels of such systems are uncorrelated, then we know that the system is many-body localized. However, already this picture done for that model shows that it is not so easy to say where the transition happens, for example, because the crossing point at which one observes crossings for data for different system sizes is moving with increasing system size to larger disorder strength. So it is not clear, for example, where the transition is, or even as some people would argue that it is not clear whether the transition is there at all, or maybe this is just a finite size feature of this model. So if one looks at this Hamiltonian in the eigenbasis of the SZ operators, then there are two features of this Hamiltonian. First of all, it is a matrix whose dimension is exponentially increasing with system size. This is just because the Hilbert space dimension is 2 to the L. If one takes into account the total SZ conservation, then it is slightly larger, but it is still exponentially large in system size L. However, this matrix is sparse in the eigenbasis of SIZ operators, because the given spin configuration can be coupled by this Hamiltonian only to a configuration that differs from the initial configuration by single spin flip, which means that each spin configuration is at most coupled to L other spin configurations, and consequently the Hamiltonian matrix is sparse. In order to be able to get better and better results for this crossover and to have better idea about many-body localization, one needs to reach as large system sizes as possible. So the question is how this sparsity of the matrix can be used in the most efficient way. So if one wants to calculate grand state or few low energy states, or in general exterior eigenpairs of such a system, so exterior meaning close to the grand state or close to the highest excited state, then there is a famous Lanczos algorithm, which is in a block version, is shown in this blurry frame. So it is blurry because it is not so important. The only thing is that, which is important, is that this algorithm employs the sparsity of the matrix, because the only thing which it does, it considers a certain initial vector and then acts with the Hamiltonian on that vector and performs then some linear algebra operations. Yeah, and the thing is that this sparse matrix times vector multiplication is the thing which can be done easily for sparse matrix. This algorithm allows one to get to transform the Hamiltonian to block three diagonal form, and then to obtain eigenvalues and eigenvectors at the ends of the spectrum of such Hamiltonian. The problem is that when we increase the number of eigenvalues we want to and eigenvectors we want to calculate with this method, then this algorithm becomes very inefficient. And one question is whether we could try to find a method which combines the good properties of this Lanczos iteration and uses the sparse pattern of the Hamiltonian matrix in the most efficient way. So one way to do that is to use the so-called Shivian invert method, which is more or less the state of the art method, or at least up to recently. And the idea is to employ a spectral transformation. Instead of Hamiltonian matrix, one considers a transformed matrix, which is shifted and inverted Hamiltonian. Then if we assume that the spectrum of our Hamiltonian is from -1 to 1, the spectrum of the transformed matrix is from -infinity to, in general, to +infinity. But the thing is that the eigenvalues at the edges of that spectrum correspond, and eigenvectors correspond, because eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the R sigma of H matrix and H matrix are the same. Eigenvectors are the same and the eigenvalues are transformed. So the eigenvalues of R sigma at the edges of its spectrum correspond to eigenstates of the H matrix in the middle of the spectrum, which means that performing Lanczos iteration for this R sigma of H matrix one can obtain the eigenvalues in the middle of the spectrum of this of the Hamiltonian. However, to perform this transformation, to perform the Lanczos iteration, one needs to act with matrix R sigma of H on vectors. And to do that, the only way is to calculate LU decomposition of the Hamiltonian. And the problem with LU decomposition is that it does not preserve the sparsity pattern of the matrix, which results in severe filling of the matrix. And this was identified as the main bottleneck of this method, at least for the quantum many body systems. So the idea of the PolFET, so the abbreviation PolFET comes from the polynomially filtered exact diagonalization method. So the idea is to use spectral transformation, which is done via order of high order polynomial. So instead of Hamiltonian, we consider a high order polynomial of the matrix. And this Hamiltonian is chosen in such a way that it is peaked strongly around certain energy. So if we again assume that the spectrum of the Hamiltonian is from minus one to one, then it is peaked around some value sigma. And to achieve that, one can choose in various ways the coefficients in this expansion. For example, one can use the coefficients of the expansion of Dirac delta around centered around energy sigma, which will give us a strongly peaked function around this sigma. And the idea is then similar. One just does the Lanczos iteration for this transformed matrix. And the good thing is that one avoids this bottleneck of the shift and invert method because acting with high order polynomial of Hamiltonian on a vector can be just translated to acting with the Hamiltonian, with the original Hamiltonian of vectors on vector and performing linear combinations of results of such calculations, which means that the sparsity pattern of the matrix is used in more efficient way in that approach. So the PolFET algorithm works in the following way. First, we rescale the Hamiltonian because generically the Hamiltonian has some ground state and some highest excited state, and we which have certain arbitrary energies. We rescale the Hamiltonian in such a way that its spectrum is from minus one to one. Then we find an order of the polynomial transformation, which has to be matched with the density of states of the Hamiltonian and the number of eigenvalues we want to obtain in this PolFET algorithm. So the number of eigenvalues which is obtained is roughly shown in the by this green gray shaded region, and knowing the value, the number of requested eigenvalues, and knowing the density of states of Hamiltonian, which can be either obtained from some analytical estimate or can be calculated efficiently for sparse matrices, we determine the order of this polynomial spectral transformation, and then we just perform Brog-Lanczos iteration for this transformed Hamiltonian, which converges after certain numbers of iterations of this Lanczos procedure, so the Lanczos procedure is again few linear algebra operations. The most important one is this action of the transformed Hamiltonian on matrix of vectors, and then there are few orthogonalization steps which are less time consuming and less important. And during execution of this PolFET algorithm, the number of converged eigenvalues is shown in here as a function of the number of steps for few various numbers of the requested eigenvalues. So the requested number of requested eigenvalues is 100 in here, 200, 1000, and 2000. We see that roughly after two times number of steps, two times larger than the number of requested eigenvalues, the algorithm converges, and then the eigenvectors to which it converges, eigenvectors of the initial Hamiltonian, to the eigenvalues which are in the middle of the spectrum of this original Hamiltonian. And this this Polfeld algorithm has few features. So first of all, the most time-consuming step is the action of this high-order polynomial on a matrix of vectors. This can be parallelized in two ways. First of all, if this QJ is matrix of vectors, then there is some, and it is, for example, let's say 20 vectors in there, then we can do action of this polynomial on each of the columns of this matrix in parallel, and then each of the products can be parallelized on its own. The second thing is that the vectors which are obtained in this action of the transformed Hamiltonian on the some initial vectors have to be stored during the during the execution of the of this algorithm. However, as we saw, only two or three time more eigenvector vectors have to be stored than the eigenvectors that the number of eigenvectors we want to calculate, and the matrix in which we can form them dominates the memory consumption of this program, and this is much lower cost than in the other ways of calculating eigenvalues in, and eigenvectors in the middle of the spectrum. Finally, there are two further pluses of this method. One advantage is that time consumption increases only linearly with increasing number of non-zero elements of this Hamiltonian H, which is not the case for other methods. For example, if you want to do this shift and invert, then you will see that the this time consumption increases much more rapidly with the increasing number of non-zero elements of this Hamiltonian. Finally, it has also a nice feature that the only thing thing which is needed in this Polfeld execution is action of the high order polynomial of the matrix on the on vectors, which means that it can be used, for example, for flocked systems, in which the flocked operator, if we only can find a good way of an efficient way of acting with flocked operator on vectors, then we can use the similar ideas to obtain eigenstates of flocked systems, which was which is hard to do with other methods. And the total flocked operator doesn't even have to be the doesn't even have to be a sparse matrix. Benchmark on the disordered spin chain is shown in this plot in this slide. And this is benchmark of the Polfeld method around and the shift and invert method, which was which is state of the art method. So for the most standard exact spin chain, as we see, the time execution as a function of system size is quite similar in Polfeld and in the shift and invert. However, memory consumption is orders of magnitude smaller for Polfeld. For example, for L equal to 26 spins, the Polfeld needs like 500 gigabytes of RAM memory, whether the shift and invert needs like more than 10 to 5 gigabytes of memory, which makes calculations with the shift and invert method very, very challenging. They need to be run on very large supercomputers. With Polfeld, one can calculate things even on few nodes of some supercomputer. And the second plots show more or less the similar story. When the number of non-zero elements is increased, then the performance of Polfeld is even better as compared to the to this shift and invert method. All right, so this concludes my my description of the Polfeld method, and now I will come back to this problem of many-body localization. So I consider either the XXZ spin chain or J1 J2 model, which is very similar. The only difference is that I have in J1, J2 model, I have couplings between neighboring spins and next nearest neighbors. And the whole problem with analyzing the Menebo delocalization transition is that it is there are very strong finite size effects at this transition, and this can be exemplified on such a plot. When one shows some property, this is rescaled bipartite entanglement entropy of eigenstates in the middle of such system, which is expected to be close to unity for ergodic system or to decrease like 1/L for localized system. As you see, that there is in the and for various disorder strengths, there is a gradual change between the two behaviors. However, in the middle, there is some kind of non-monotonic re-entrant behavior in which the system's first flows towards something which looks localized, because with increasing system size, the rescaled entanglement entropy is decreasing, but then at certain length scale, it starts to increase. And the same story can be obtained from this average gap ratio, which is obtained just from the eigenvalues. So to analyze this crossover, I have considered the following disorder strengths, WT and W star. And WT of L is a deviation from the ergodic behavior, and it is obtained for given system size, L, at the point at which the average gap ratio crosses this red dashed line, which is taken to be a little bit smaller than the value expected for the ergodic system. And W star of L is an estimate of the transition at given system size. It is just crossing point of the data for two system sizes. And now if one looks at such a crossover and plots the two disorder strengths as a function of L, or rather as a function of 1/L, one obtains plots like that. So horizontal axis shows vertical axis shows 1/L, which means that the thermodynamic limit is here. And the horizontal axis shows disorder strengths, and the two plots are for the either J1, J2 or XXZ model. The two models behave in a very similar way. This crossing point can be very nicely described by 1/L behavior, which suggests that the systems do become Menebo delocalized, and one could extrapolate this 1/L behavior to infinity, obtaining some estimate of critical disorder strength. However, the story is not so simple, because this WT deviation from the ergodicity behaves linearly in L for the system sizes which can be obtained with numerical method accessible at the moment, which means that the two scalings are in fact incompatible, because one has to have WT smaller than W star at all system sizes just by definition, which means that either of the scalings must break down at a value smaller than the L equal to 50, which is obtained from the extrapolation of the two scalings. They cross, and it's clear that one of them has to cease working. So there are actually two possible scenarios. Either this W star 1/L scaling works, and then this WT linear scaling in system size adapts to it at a certain length scale, or it's the other way around. The W star of L ceases to be 1/L, but starts to be increasing linearly with system size, which would mean that there is no Menebo delocalization. So trying to understand this scaling is quite interesting. So motivated by this picture, we looked at other class of pin chains, in which one can actually get data for larger system sizes, and those class of spin chains is motivated by recent experiments with Rydberg atoms, and for such chains of Rydberg atoms, one can enter a blockade regime in which the Hilbert space is effectively constrained in such a way that there are no two spin-up states at distance smaller than alpha, where alpha is the blockade range. Usually the blockade range is one, and then one obtains the PXP model, which is the famous model in which the quantum many body scars were first observed and then understood. But this alpha in this talk will be just a parameter which can be also larger than one, and then I will get a class, a family of constraint spin chains with the property that its Hilbert space dimension is increasing more and more slowly with increasing range of this blockade regime. So for alpha equal to zero, no blockade, then the Hilbert space is just 2 to the L. And for alpha equal to one, it's 161. And then for larger values of alpha, this value, which is then taken to the Lth power, is smaller and smaller, which allows one to get larger and larger system sizes for increasing blockade radius. And if I now, so I look at this system. So I have the system with constraint and I add this order and to look at the similar things as I did for the for these standard spin chains in which many body localization is well studied. And when I did the similar extraction of WT and W star, I obtained the results which are shown in here. Now the system size is shown on the horizontal axis and the disorder strengths are shown on the vertical axis. Yeah, and the main thing is that what we observe is that at sufficiently large system sizes, we observe just linear drifts of this disorder strength, which suggests that those systems aren't really many body localized. Even though at given system size, we do see a crossover between ergodic and localized behavior, the interplay the change of this crossover with increasing system size is such that it just shifts to larger and larger disorder strengths, more or less linearly with system size at sufficiently large system sizes, which means that there is no many body localization in such systems. So trying to understand this, one thing is that for those constraint models, one is able to get much larger system sizes. So 26 for alpha equal to one, but once we have constraint radius equal to two, then we are able to reach like 34 spins, and for alpha equal to five, we can reach 50 spins, which is larger system. However, the properties of the Fock space are quite different. Yeah. So if we look at the Hamiltonian of the system, and first forget about this term, the eigenstates of this term are just the eigenstates of SIZ operators. So these are certain spin configurations. And if we try to do, if we assume that this is large and this is a perturbation, this will be just a perturbation which couples certain spin configuration to other configurations. And one can introduce a quantity called, which we call the radius of Hilbert space in such a way that assume that we have certain spin configuration. And if we act with the kinetic part of the Hamiltonian, then we obtain a certain number of spin configurations. And now if we act with the Hamiltonian on all of those configurations, then we obtain larger and larger and larger number of spin configurations. And the number of times with which we act with the kinetic term of the Hamiltonian operators on given spin configuration until we reach the whole Hilbert space is a certain variable R. And then if we average this variable R over various initial spin configurations, then we obtain a quantity which characterizes this Fock space of the constraint systems. And one can expect that if this radius is small, which means that a small number of actions of the kinetic term is sufficient to reach all of the spin configurations from the given spin configuration, then we expect that the system will be much more prone to delocalization because this term will be acting more efficiently. So if we look at disorder PXP models with and plot the radius of Hilbert space as function of system size, for various radius of constraints, we see that with increasing various radius of constraint, the radius of Hilbert space is much more slowly increasing with system size, which means that the delocalization in those systems is not so unexpected. It might be just traced back to the fact that this term is just much more is becoming much more effective with increasing radius of constraint. So this brought us to consider another class of constraint spin chains, in which you also have a disorder, on-site disorder term, and we have the same kind of constraint which prevents us from having two spins up, or in the language of particles, two occupied sites at a distance smaller than alpha. But now we have just a hopping term, which means that we have conserved number of particles, and this model has the property that the Hilbert space radius is increasing linearly with L for arbitrary alpha, just because of this. Just because of the different nature of the kinetic term, and we considered some symmetry, some total SZ or some number of particles in the system, so some certain filling, and what we obtained from the same analysis is that this model is again becoming delocalized in a large L limit for sufficiently large radius of constraint. And this was quite surprising for us. And then we thought about the one interesting property of this system with conserved number of particles. If we look at this Hamiltonian and forget about disorder term, then those particles are actually behaving as a particles with a radius. This may be visible in this figure. So few sites are occupied by green particles. The particles can hop to adjacent sites, and they cannot hop to a site if a particle is neighboring to that site. This is for radius of constraint equal to unity. This means that with each of the particles, I can associate an excluded volume. I can, for example, which for alpha equal to one, I can associate with each particle a site left right to it, and say that this is a new particle, and then I can shrink the whole chain, which means that I obtain from a system with constraint, I obtain a system which is unconstrained, and as you see, the hoppings which are possible in this chain are the same as hoppings in this chain. For example, the third particle can hop only to the right, cannot hop to the left. In the constrained case, because of the constraint radius equal to alpha, in the unconstrained case, just because there is particle to the left of it. And the particles are Hartree bosons. So this effect actually gives us mapping between constraint model and unconstrained model, which allows us to translate each of the states of this constraint spin chain. So this is just a state, which means that this is Fock state. This is a representation of state in Fock space. So this shows us which of the sites are occupied in the constraint model. Then if we add a zero at the end of this state, and then take zero, which is after each occupied site in this constraint model, and we forget about the zero, we attach it to the particle, then we obtain an unconstrained model, which tells us that n particles on L sites in a model of constraint with constraint radius alpha and open boundary conditions can be exactly mapped to n particles on L minus alpha times n minus one sites in unconstrained model. And this is exact mapping between the Hamiltonians, because the hoppings are the same in the constrained and unconstrained cases, which means that in the absence of this term, this model is actually non-interacting. However, as I was saying, if we have non-zero value of W, I was observing a crossover between ergodic and localized behavior, and ergodic behavior can be obtained only if the interactions are in the system, which means that this disorder term actually introduces interactions to the system. And this can be seen in the via the same mapping. So the mapping is repeated here. And now if we look at, if we introduce disorder to the system and we look at the constraint model, each of the particle is experiencing a field with the number which corresponds to the site at which the particle is. If we do the mapping, then the energy of such state must be the same, which means that the first particle has feels potential H1, the second particle feels potential H3, and the last particle feels potential H7, which means that the mapping between the potentials is affected, is changed in a non-trivial way by this transformation. And so actually this particle is feeling potential H3, even though it is on the site number two, if we start numbering the sites from zero, just because there is one particle to the left of it. And this particle feels potential H7, even though it is on fifth site. Which means that there are correlations between the particles. The particle feels potential which is shifted if there is certain number of particles to its left. And this can be this just means that the this disorder term in the in the constraint model can be written as a disorder term plus all-to-all interactions of infinite range between particles in the unconstrained model, which somehow explains why there is no many-body localization in the system. It is just because the interactions are of infinite range, and their strength is increasing with disorder strength. And we believe that that is why we do not see localization in this model. Which also means that one has to be careful when one identifies disorder term. In this system, disorder term is actually also introducing interactions to a representation in which the particles move in unconstrained way. And that's why the models are not localized. So this brings me to my conclusions. So first of all, the PolFET is a method which utilizes the sparse structure of Hamiltonian matrix to efficiently obtain highly excited eigenstates, which are needed in studies of systems out of equilibrium, for example, in trying to obtain information about many-body localization and or about ergodicity of isolated quantum many-body systems. And the other take-home message is that at the moment, at least from the numerical perspective, it's hard to reach unambiguous conclusions about many-body localization transition. And the constraints models, which we considered because we thought that we can access larger system sizes, actually are not many-body localized, even at strong disorder strengths. And this is due to peculiar interplay between disorder term and constraint terms, which actually introduce interactions to those systems. Okay, so that would be it. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you for the nice talk. We have plenty of time, so it's a good time to ask questions or give some comments. Maybe I start. I probably just missed this part about the finite size effect in many-body localization. Can you go there?
This one?
Yeah, this one at previous, I think, as well. Mm-hmm. One slide before. This one, let's see. As you said, with increase of L, there is decrease and then increase.
Exactly.
Yes. But is it monotonous further up to L50, as you said?
Exactly. So this is what is not known. So the problem is that once we know that there is such kind of behavior in the system, then at least at certain intermediate disorder strengths, then we can always be worried that if we look at large disorder and we see that the with increasing size our entanglement entropy is decreasing, then we can always be worried that at some point it starts to increase. So to somehow see how monotonic this behavior is, I looked at those crossings. So actually, if you think about it, the crossing for various system sizes happens if the curve in here is flat. This means that the entanglement entropy for L equal to 10 and L equal to 12 is equal to each other, which means that for such data there is crossing. So tracing the minima of those curves is the same as tracing the crossings of those curves. And tracing those crossings gives you this data, which are quite clearly changing like one over L, which would suggest that there is monomodal localization, which so the trend is quite clear. Yeah, however, there is this problem that the other part of the crossover is not really adjusting to this to this scaling, at least at the system sizes we can access in numerics. So to really see whether this part of the crossing, this WT, this deviation from the GOE, from the ergodic behavior, is adjusting to this behavior of crossing points, then one would need larger system sizes, and this is not accessible currently.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but the hope is that there is, at least for me, is that one can find models in which this, let's say this crossing happens at smaller system sizes, because it could be that for different types of models, this crossing happens at smaller length scales that can be actually reached in numerics. Yeah, and also the problem is that all of the other approaches to monomodal localization are somehow inspired by numerics. So it is quite important what we see in numerics. Besides the very first approach to monomodal localization, which was perturbative argument. But this is a different story, maybe.
Okay, and maybe another question about the last part of your talk and constraints. Yeah, when you when you actually, it was a very nice observation that the effective side of the chain is reduced because you used to have like one side particle, but now you have n side particles. And initially, I thought, initially, I thought there will be like if alpha is one, then you have a particle of linear size two, but it's not so trivial. It's constrained how the cores of this excitation, let's say, can come close to each other, but they can still share this neighboring size. Yes.
So that's how I think about it. So I think about each of the particles as particle for alpha equal to one as particle of radius two, and it is just so this particle has radius two and it occupies this side and actually this side. This particle occupies this side and this side, and this particle occupies those two sides. And then in such and then if you shrink those particles, then they just move exactly as ordinary hardcore bosons. So for example, because this particle is radius two, then it cannot hop on top of this particle. And so this is how the constraint works. And this is what allows one to do the exact mapping in the systems without this disorder between the constrained and unconstrained case. And the spectrum of the Hamiltonian is the same. However, it is not all the features are the same because the mapping is not fully local, which means that, for example, the entanglement entropy could be changed.
Mm-hmm. I see. And I saw on the previous slide that increasing radius of your constraints, you can increase radius of the length of your chains, but in some sense, it's just rescaling of going to the larger radius hardcore bosons.
You are talking about this one?
Yeah, like alpha 16 and alpha 1.
Okay, so there is important distinction between this model, which conserves the number of particles, and mm-hmm. then you really can think about particles which do hop, and between this model, which does not constrain the number of particles, doesn't conserve the number of particles. If you translate it via Jordan Weil transformation to hardcore bosons, then you will see that this term is just A plus A dagger,
yes,
which means that you can create and annihilate occupation particles just like that, which is probably like the, for example, in superconductors. But the thing is that when you can do that, when you are allowed to change the number of particles, then you get this problem with the decreasing radius of Hilbert space with increasing radius of constraints, which is not the case for that model, because then for example, in such a system with large constraint, to get if you have certain spin configuration, you can just de-excite all of the spins to spins down state, and then excite whenever you want the spins, and you can reach in few steps all of the states. This is not the case for a system with conserved number of particles, because then the particles have to hop between the adjacent sites, which means that there is many actions of the kinetic term needed in order to reach all of the states from given Fock space configuration.
That's verification. Are there other questions or comments?
Okay, I mean, this might be a stupid question. Like, how would the graph that you showed previously about the crossing, I mean, how would the graph change if there was MPL, then this, you know, the previous one, I guess.
Yes. This one, for example. Exactly. So we claim that there is no MPL in those systems, because we see linear drift of this crossing point. So if there was a localized phase, then we would expect the saturation of this curve with increasing L, and saturation to critical value. And most probably, if you also want to have just a transition, then we would also want to have this line to approach the, so this WT to approach W star and to merge at some point in the critical point, in such a way we would obtain a step function, which would be something which is expected for a transition, right? We want to have the deviation from the ergodic value, and then we want to abruptly decrease value of our observable to the localized value. So saturation of this curve and approach of the WT to the crossing points curve. This is what would be seen for a system which is becoming localized.
And in the bottom curve, that this crossing will not be there.
You mean those ones? So these are also here. Exactly. So these are different variables. So in here, L is increasing if you go to in that direction vertically. And then if we have amenable localization, then we would expect that this curve in the thermodynamic limit, so 1 over L going to 0, reaches some finite value of W, and this curve, this WT adapts to it at some point, and then also reaches the same critical disorder strength for infinite chain. Does that make sense?
Yes. And does this depend on the kind of observable that you are studying?
Yeah, it's a good question. So actually, there are two observables shown here, which I did not mention. So I can do such analysis of the crossover either for this gap ratio, which is just pure level statistics. I do not look at eigenstates at all, or I can look also at properties of entanglement entropy of eigenstates. And then if I normalize this entanglement entropy of eigenstates in such a way that it is equal to unity in ergodic regime, then I get very similar crossover of this rescaled entanglement entropy as function of disorder strength, and I can analyze it with the same disorder strengths, and this W star R, the blue points are from this entanglement entropy. So as you see, the two observables, either the orange points which are from these orange points are from entanglement entropy, and blue points which are from the gap ratio, give you very similar behavior. So this is what would be, yeah. So those two observables are consistent. So I would expect that other observables are consistent as well.
Thanks.
And they do change in, if there is transition, they do change in discontinuous manner in thermodynamics.
Last question, sorry. Okay, if there is an other questions, please go ahead. I mean, is there a model where like you get all these points exactly cross each other, or that's still like
so if I want to have a model in which I have ergodic phase and I have localized phase, and if it is in the interacting model, then I do not have, at the moment, I do not have a model in which I have clear evidence for either of the behavior. The closest model, in some sense, close to many body localization and close to, but simpler is Anderson model on random regular graphs. And this model can be studied analytically, and it is known to have critical disorder strength like equal to 18.1, which is for certain properties of this random regular graph. And this shows the similar figure as I was showing you before for that model. So what is obtained for this system? So I again get the crossover between a delocalized phase, ergodic phase, and the localized phase. I analyze it in terms of these crossing points and in terms of this WT, and I obtain the following behavior. So this is the 1 over log 2 of n, where n is the size of this random regular graph. So thermodynamic limit is again at zero. As a function of disorder strength, I see such behavior. And then if I extrapolate this behavior, now it is not like 1 over L, but like not 1 over this variable, but there is second order polynomial in this variable. Then I get something which is quite close to the critical disorder strength. And the nice feature of this Anderson transition random regular graph is that this ergodic boundary is already starting to adapt to these crossing points. So if we have, so the dashed line, black dashed line shows the linear behavior, and at sufficiently large system size, there is there is deviation from this linear behavior. The increase of this WT is slower, and that curve starts to adapt to it. But as you see, they are still quite far from each other. And So there is another crossing point now of this modified extrapolated point, and then to really see whether, if they are not crossing each other, then one need to reach system sizes again roughly 50, which is 50 by 50 I mean 2 to 50, the size of the random regular graph, which is again not accessible. But for this model, it is known that there is the transition. So this actually is a kind of check whether my method of extrapolation has any sense. So it does, because it gives you roughly sensible value of critical disorder strength as compared to the value which is known analytically.
Okay. Thank you.
Other questions or comments? Seems that this was the case. Then again, I thank Piotr on behalf of all the participants for this very interesting talk. And I can conclude this session by thanking Adriana, Pierre, and ACTP for making this very nice conference possible. And I give the floor to Pierre and Adriana in case they want to make some concluding remarks.
Thank you very much, Andrei. So, Adriano, do you want to do the closing remarks?
Yeah. So, first of all, also on behalf of Pierre and pretty much of this, I wanted to thank everybody that participated, both the speakers, the panelists, chairmen, the audience, for just, you know, taking your time to sit down with us and show us your work, show us what you do. One of the reasons why we wanted to do this is that we really wanted to try and fix the fact that it's very, very common that we don't know what the guy that works next door to us does, which is something that we should really try to avoid. This is our little, you know, stepping stone towards trying to avoid something like this. I also wanted to thank the large number of people. I was actually really, really surprised by this, that took the time in their talks to start with introductions about their fields, introductions about what they do, and explaining things to people that were not specialists into their topics and into the subject of their research. This was a really good effort that I felt should be acknowledged, because not all of us are specialists in everything. And so it really helps if we go in steps and we explain what we are doing before going in with, you know, the interesting stuff. And Pierre and I are very pleased to see the amount of questions, the amount of interactions that have been going on. Hopefully this will also bloom into something more, only time will tell. But this was also one of the intents of our conference. So we're pretty satisfied about this. And that pretty much concludes what I wanted to say. Now, I don't know if Pierre wants to say something more.
No, I think you summarized my feelings quite well. So we really hope that you got something out of this conference, scientifically and also perhaps in terms of connection with, as Adriano was mentioning, the person next door that maybe you have been eating with, but you may not have known the content of his or her work. Now you do. And we hope that with both the knowledge and let's say networking that you did during this conference, you will be able to use it in your career in the future. But in the meantime, I thank every speakers. I thank every participant. And I wish you all a good Eastern holidays if you take some. And I wish you farewell until the next time. Goodbye.
By the way, next year we won't be, one last thing, next year we won't be here, neither Pierre nor I, to organize this thing, but we've already received questions about, can we do it next year? So if somebody wants to step up and organize the thing, please do, and maybe call us. We will try and see what we can do.
Yes, if you need some tips. Otherwise, Godspeed, everybody.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
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 Bye. Bye.
Bye. Bye.